And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Say with me very loud, I am born of God. So he says, be not conformed, but be transformed. He uses two words there. And then the word conform in the Greek is the word somopho. It means to adapt something for what it is not designed for. To adapt something for what it was not made for. For example, this is my cell phone. This is my cell phone. But if I use my phone to eat rice, I am conforming this phone into what the phone was not created for. Quite all right, it will scoop some grains of rice and put in my mouth, but that's not the purpose for which a phone was designed. Be not conformed to this world means don't allow the world to squeeze you into their system, because you will be a misfit. Why? You were not designed for their system. Be not conformed. Meaning you are adapting yourself for what you are not meant for. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed, metamorphosis, or to metamorphose, or to metamorphosize, where you have the egg, the larva, you know, where you come into your own manifested character, full blown, where what is inside you expresses itself. Metamorphosis. Metamorphosis is not copying something. Metamorphosis is what is inside coming out full blown. So metamorphosis is inside out. Conform is you being squeezed outside into what you are not designed for. So he says, rather than adapt yourself to a character outside you, let there be an outward expression of the character inside you. So if you are going to have that expression, he says, do not be conformed to this world, because the god of this world is Satan. And what does he operate through? The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. There's no point trying to explain it away. You are not of this world. That's why I get very shocked and I get seriously shaken when Christian ministers, preachers of the gospel, invite unbelievers to come and speak in churches. Unbelievers, Satan's children, to come and speak to God's children. Satan's children. I don't care their expertise. They are still Satan's children. They tell you, you know, the guy is experienced in the industry. He knows things. Is that the role of the pastor? The Bible says, where is the meeting point? This is church. This is not school. It's in the universities. They look for experienced, successful career people. Not church. Church is the pillar and ground of the truth. It's where we dispense the knowledge of Christ. This is where we renew our mind from the things we learned in school. This is where we renew our mind from the things we learned in school. So for a pastor to bring an experienced unbeliever to come and speak to believers, darkness talking to light, the Bible says you are not of this world. In Ephesians chapter 5, he says we are not growing. When a man is not growing in Christ, it will reflect in the kind of relationships he keeps. As you are sitting here now, think about your friends. It's a reflection of whether you're growing or not. You don't even need me to close eyes and prophesy. Right now, you know whether you're a spiritual dwarf or you're growing. Your relationship reflects your status in growth. If your confidence are more outside the church, outside Christ, it means you are not growing. Or maybe you're not born again. Because darkness will feel at home in darkness. You cannot outgrow your relationships. You cannot outgrow your relationships. You are always in church. Always. You have Christians around you. That doesn't still mean those are your relationships. You can be with us, be in church, always be here, greet us well, but your real friends are unbelievers. Those are the people, when you are with them, you feel at home. You let down your guard. You are yourself. But when you are with us, you act brother. Bless your heart, brother. Glory to God. Glory. Glory. But you're acting. Then when you meet unbelievers, please bring that bottle of whiskey. Bring it. Bring it. Let a man wash down. That is a reflection of your true identity. Where you feel at home is a reflection of who you are. I can can never feel at home among unbelievers, not even by mistake. When I'm among unbelievers, it's like I have entered an environment where I must be careful how I operate. I can't feel at home with them. No. Far be it. My words are guarded. My utterances are well controlled. My mannerisms are controlled. And the length of my stay is very short. I can't last among them. Why? I don't belong. I'm not acting. I just don't belong. Your relationships are where you feel at home. When you are there, you are just at home. That's where your real relationships are. And if a believer is feeling at home with unbelievers, it means your mind has not been renewed. It means you are not feeding. It means you are not learning. It means we are wasting energy on you. Because if you are feeding on this diet, it will change your appetite. Your appetite will change. And once your appetite changes, your relationships will change. When you start feeding on the diet of Christ, you may not be excited. But if you stay with it, it will start changing your taste. When I used to stay in the north, there was a particular food they used to give me in the north then that I liked very much. I liked that food very well. I can eat it every day, every day, every day. When I came to Akwa Ibom, the condiments for that food is not here, so it's not available. Over the years, my appetite has changed and my taste has changed. I didn't know. So recently, I asked them to look for that food and bring it. They brought it. The moment I tasted it,
what is this?
No, they didn't do it well. They said, this is the best way it is done. I said, oh, my appetite has changed. I can't eat it anymore. Your taste changes when you start feeding on the right food, even naturally. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 3 and 4. But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becometh saints. Next verse. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. All the things I listed now are in our movies. Everything I listed is in the movies we watch. Today, if the movies don't have these things, it is not a movie. Fornication, adultery, nakedness, strife, competition, they are what constitutes our movie industries. And they are part of the world. Some believers are amused by silly jokes. Silly jokes. Very ungodly jokes. You know ungodly jokes? Very ungodly jokes. They call it comedy. And they will sit down and be laughing as if they have been, a spell has been cast on them. Just things that you should hear and your spirit is wounded. You feel, jokes that when they are released, it's like they are piercing you with sword. Because, but a believer will relax. As if he's sniffing in laughing gas. Filthy stuff. How did you get there? Look at verse 5 to 7 of that Ephesians. Ephesians 5, 5 to 7. Glory to God. Ephesians 5, verse 5 to 7. Put it up for me quickly. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 5 to 7. Who is there? For this you know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Verse 6. Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them. Partakers means to fellowship or to have something in common with them. Look at verse 8 to 11. For you were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. Next verse. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. Some of us cannot reprove those things because they are our friends and we don't want to lose them. So we're fellowshipping in the afternoon with the unfruitful works of darkness. There's no fellowship between the believer and an unbeliever whatsoever. You cannot be friends. When I mean you cannot be a friend of an unbeliever, I mean you cannot be their friend. You cannot be their confidant. You cannot be their intimate relationship. It's not possible. Light and darkness. That's why many believers struggle with marriage when it's time for them to get married. They struggle because they are confused. Because most of them had different relationships in life. So because of variety of relationships, they have been into all kinds of relationships. So now they are confused. They don't know which of them is good. So their ideas about life is colored. Their friends, believers, unbelievers, gutter believers, church goers, non-believers, atheists, semi-atheists, lesbians, homosexuals, all of them are their friends. So they are all over the place. So now they don't even know which one is which. They are confused. If you call an unbeliever your brother, that means Satan is your father. Stand up. If you call an unbeliever your brother, that means Satan is your father. Seller. Is that a good place to close? We'll continue in the next half. What did I say? Some of you can't say it. Some of you can't say it. Because right now, you are looking for how to break it. To break that relationship. Friends, it's going to be exciting the next few weeks. Because we're going to do a lot on relationships. Generally, everything relationship. Husband, wife, business, contemporaries, colleagues in the office, political open affiliations, everything. Parents that are not believers, parents that are believers, husbands that are believers, wives that are unbelievers, husbands that are unbelievers, wife believers, or anything you know is relationship. We're going to get into them doctrinal, no sentiments, so that you know how to relate with different relationships in life and make the best that God has for you. Can I have a good amen? I want to hear a better amen. Amen. Even if this thing is hitting you hard, just shake it. Say that amen by faith. Say with me, I am light. I walk in the light. I have no fellowship with the unfruitful work of darkness. Satan is my enemy. The world hates me. The world hates me. I am not of the world. I am in the world, but I'm not of the world. I have on my life the call of God, the mandate of God. I'm a new creation. Therefore, in the name of Jesus, I live a purposeful life. I live a life that reflects the light of God. I am light. Therefore, my light will shine before men. They will see my good works and glorify my Father, which is in heaven. I didn't have a good amen. Amen.